Okay, so welcome, Shimon. Welcome to this little interview. We are going to talk today about the Open Benchtable and your role in this project as a designer working for Streacom. So quickly about, first introduce yourself and tell us who you are, what you're doing, where you live, things like that.
Okay, so first of all, hi Tim. Thanks for having me. So my name is Shimon. I work for Streacom as head of the design and manufacturing. So I'm based here in China, and yeah, my responsibility is basically to lead the company in terms of product direction and supervise the manufacturing and make sure that the products come out the way we want them to be.
So about Streacom itself, since how long does the company exist? What does the company do in terms of products? What it is known for in the market? Can you tell us a little bit more about that business?
Sure. So Streacom was actually originally set up in 2010. And I mean, the main products that people know us for, ones that don't know us, we're a case company. But we're slightly different in the sense of where we focus. So I think a majority of case manufacturers, they do gaming, they do standard PC cases and nothing particularly special, but what we do is we focus on fanless, on compact. We're very design orientated. We're very focused on quality, so that the materials we work with and the processes we use, they're very premium orientated. And it's a kind of more of lifestyle product rather than a typical PC enclosure. So that's really where we differentiate ourselves from the rest of the market, which tend to be, maybe more novelty driven, design trends rather than something which is maybe more minimalistic and kind of timeless designs. That's what we do.
So you're trying to build basically PC cases that have a very simple design that people can have at home and that would stay at home and being used for years and years to come, right?
Exactly, yes. And also, you know, we do have a kind of focus on small form factor and fanless. So we're trying to make the discrete rather than, you know, in your face with, you know, the typical gaming style and LED lighting and so forth. It's a little bit more classy, maybe.
Okay. So at Computex, I remember this year, right, you launched a case for Mini ITX, since you were talking about small cases. So that case is like a cube, right?
Yes.
That's exactly the type of product you guys are working on.
Exactly. It's still a PC case, but, we think it's different. And it's different in a way, it's not just for the sake of being different, but to try and achieve something. So it is fanless. It does look like a piece of art, you know. It doesn't have that generic PC feel about it, and that's what we're about.
Okay, brilliant. So since we are talking about Computex, that's actually where the whole Open Benchtable project sort of started. So that was back in 2015. So that's the year where Truthman, so Isai and myself, we came to visit you guys on your Computex booth that was in the 101 back then. What was your first thought when you heard about the project? Because initially we were actually not there to talk about that. It just ended up being like, okay, about the discussion.
Yeah, I think actually what happened was, you saw what we do, and I'm assuming you thought, actually, this is quite nice. Wouldn't it be good if we could do a bench table which had that similar kind of quality and style about it? And I think when you first mentioned the idea of a bench table for portability, well, to be honest, I'm not into the whole overclocking scene. So I initially thought, I didn't realize you needed it to be portable, but okay. and then my next reaction was, there must be something out there. And I think it was only after the meeting when I started looking for what kind of products were available for overclocking. I think it's only at that point that I realized no one had really given any attention to this, regardless of the portability element, even the standard tables. All of them, or the majority of them, seem to be just adapted ATX cases without frames around them. So I think that's what really interested me was the fact that this hadn't really been tackled before, certainly not using our approach, or you know, the Streacom way of trying to do something a little bit different and bring some, you know, element of high quality to this. So I think, yeah, that's what interested me in you know, starting this project with you.
We are mentioning the design approach that that Streacom has, and that is very particular to your products. What was the design process or the logic that went behind the design of this table? How did you approach the problem at first, and how did you solve the different challenges?
Well, I think that actually, you know, the portability and being lightweight, I think that works very well with the way we approach our design in general, because of the simplicity element. So once you simplify any product, you know, you have less components, you have in principle less weight. So I think that's one of the elements that made it easy for us to come up with a solution. And of course, the fact that we don't kind of add unnecessary complexity to it. So it can be simple, it can be comprising of less parts, so exactly that's what leads to the weight and the portability, and of course using aluminium, so it's extremely lightweight metal, and of course if it's done right and you know how to engineer well with it, then it's also, you know, strong enough to support everything that you need for a bench table.
Okay, so when you started working on the project, so first you were mentioning you researched a bit the market to see what was out there. What was the next step basically following that?
Okay, so I think at that point our initial thought was, okay, I think you need to define what it needs to do. So in terms of spec, you know, what's the type of motherboards it needs to support, PSU size it needs to support. And then beyond that, I think it was really just down to, okay, here's a blank piece of paper. This is what it needs to do. Anything can be put down. And of course, the initial idea was a flat table. I think that's obvious that it was going to be something like that. But with the design process, what you normally need to have is the brief. And then I think it's a moment where you kind of have like the inspiration idea. So it's not really sure when that happens, but you know, you hopefully it happens sooner rather than later. But I think at that point you have an idea which makes that product a differentiator or gives it its character. So for me, that was the point where with the feet and the handle, and I think that has always been the defining characteristic of the bench table. Even if you compare the final product to the early prototype, that element hasn't really changed, and I think that's was the defining moment of the product is to the feet layout, the shape of the feet, the way they fit into the table, and the carry handle.
So the very early prototypes were just below 3 kilos; they were like 2.5 kilos. And then the final one, the commercial bench table that exists on the market right now, this one is 1.82 kilos. So what went after the prototyping into finalizing the final bench table? How come there was also so much weight loss as well?
I think the key element to that was the fact that we committed to producing a product, as opposed to the prototype, which was, okay, we're going to do a very low volume and get feedback out. So when we really committed to producing the product, there was the major change was the fact that we went from just standard off-the-shelf screws to custom screws. And by doing that, what it allowed us to achieve was to get rid of all the additional parts. So, for example, the acryl, right? We had this top and bottom acryl, which we used to create the compartments to store the screws. But because we have completely custom screw set now, we were able to think, okay, how can we fix these custom screws without the need of extra parts to do that? Because they're superfluous, those parts. So that's, of course, when we thought about fitting them to the table directly to the feet. And so that saved a lot of weight just from those two acryl parts. Plus the screws that we had before, again, because they were not optimized, they were heavier than the screw set we have now. So So it's actually the acryl and the screws. Plus, we do have a little bit more CNC going on this table, so we have reduced the amount of aluminium a little bit, but generally it was the change in design that saved the weight.
Mm-hmm. So, like you mentioned, the screws are quite special on that table, right? What are the tools that are needed for someone that would buy a table and that want to assemble it? Does he need to have some screwdrivers or things like that?
No, actually, all the screws are thumb screws. So, unless you want to apply a little bit of extra pressure, to lock things in more securely, you really don't need any tools to assemble it.
Okay, that's pretty cool. So those screws, you can also use a screwdriver as well, like as well as being thumb screws.
Oh yes, you can. Yeah. You can. Okay. If you choose to.
Okay, so one of the next things about that table is that initially we had that overclocking approach into why we were building this table. But of course, as we went, like we were also talking more about more like a regular people or PC enthusiast people that like to see their components on the tables, or people on the field that would use the table as a regular testing stations and things like that. But for overclockers, one of the main concern was that the table would be solid enough to support a fully extreme overclocked system, for example, with one LN2 pod on the CPU, four graphics card with their pods, extra possible pods on the memory as well. So that would have been a very important load on the table, and the heavy duty aspect was quite important. How do you choose the materials and the type of aluminium for that kind of use?
Actually, that wasn't a very big concern for me, the weight element, because I knew that we were going to be working with a fairly thick piece of aluminium to start with, just because, for example, even at 4 millimeters, aluminium is not going to bend unless you apply a fair amount of pressure to it. And I knew that we were going to be working with something more than that. So I wasn't so concerned about the amount of weight that it had to support. The things that worry me were more the elements that we hadn't considered. So always, as a designer, when you're producing any product, the problems that you know about are the ones you don't need to worry about. It's the ones that you don't know about which are worrying me. So, that wasn't a concern for me, because I knew that we could test for it, and I knew that we were going to be working with at least 8 millimeters. So, I was fairly confident that it would support anything that was put on top of it.
Okay, what were, for example, the things you didn't know about that you realized when you were working on the project? Or like maybe that we didn't have thought of, for example?
Well, I think the really big one, which was very strange that we didn't consider that earlier, was the brackets for mounting all in one. So that was a really big a schoolboy error to have omitted that on the prototype. But at least it gave something for people to look forward to, I think, on the final version, that we solved that problem.
So speaking about those brackets, right, are they cut out of the table itself, or is that, how do you get those, the material for it?
Well, I think, okay, well, one of the other important things, I'm not sure we mentioned it at all or enough, was that we are going to put the plans online and the table, if someone has a CNC machine at home, I'm not sure how many people do, but let's say people do have access to CNC machines, they can make their own table. And for those people who would be milling it out for themselves at home, yes, those brackets, they are actually cut out from the holes which are also in the table. So the feet and the brackets, everything for the table, other than the screws, everything comes from that single piece of aluminium. But actually, for the production process that we're using now, and this is just to speed things up, actually, and it's slightly more cost efficient, we are making the brackets out of a separate piece of aluminium, but it's still designed so that you could cut it out of that single piece.
Okay, so when you basically will take those production brackets, for example, they will fit straight into where it's supposed to be cut off the table anyway, right?
Exactly, the size and shape, everything is as if they were cut out from that point. And in fact, the early samples that we made, that's how it was done.
Okay. So for the manufacturing, you say you're using CNC. How does the process looks like? How does it work to cut out a piece of aluminium and make a table out of it?
Okay, so I think this is something else which would be useful if we add a video at some point. But to give a basic explanation, you have already a pre-cut slab of aluminium, already 8 millimeters thick, and what you do is you have a jig which locks it in place inside a CNC machine, and the CNC basically has an X and Y cutting, right, as well as the Z, which is the up and down. So you have a different set of drill bits, and what that does is it basically moves the aluminium, and you have a high speed drill, and that basically wherever the drill makes contact with the aluminium, that's where it gets cut. So depending on the size of the drill bit and the position of the X and Y and the Z, you basically just cut out the aluminium.
Okay, so that kind of tooling is not that easy for everyone to get, right?
It's not something people typically have at home.
You don't buy that at the supermarket. I mean,
no, you don't. But there are places that do have milling machines available, and I have actually seen some manufacturers looking at producing maybe not large milling machines, but certainly small ones which are comparable to 3D printers. I think it's, maybe not in the next year, but certainly I think that there will come a time where you do have, home milling machines. And in that way, it's something which could be eventually produced at home even.
Yeah. So for the production process and the machine, for example, how many tables can a CNC machine do per day? How long does it take to cut every pieces out and have sort of the final cutout?
Okay, it's difficult to give exact number because it's done in stages. So you wouldn't just have a beginning to end in one machine in one go. And again, this is more to do with just optimizing it for manufacturing. But you would do a single process on maybe 100 tables, and then you would take it to the next CNC machine and do another set of processes. And don't forget, because the table right now, and this is again a very big difference from the prototype, that the prototype was only had to be CNC'd on a single side, actually two sides, on the top and bottom side. Mm-hmm. But with the addition of the brackets and the way that the screws fix, so we have now CNCing on all six sides. So you have to basically stop the machine, take out the semi-finished aluminium, and then turn it to a different angle, different position, and then do the other edges. So it's a fairly intensive process if you're doing just one piece. So from beginning to end, you have to start, stop. So in that way, we do a whole batch of one specific process, and then we'll put it through the machine again and do another process. So it's difficult to quantify exactly how many you do in one day, because you don't actually finish a single table in one day.
Okay, I see. So once it comes out of that machine, the aluminium still looks very very raw, right? It looks nothing like the table you get in the end. So what does it get? How do you get that final finish on the table? That kind of feel to the touch and the color, etc.
Okay, so after, as you say, it's raw aluminium. It does have a lot of small marks on the surface, so it's not perfect surface. So what we have to do after that is first to polish the surface from any defects. So any damage that can even happen in handling or putting into the CNC machine. This is a very common place where you get damage onto the aluminium surface. So first is to polish it to make sure that there are no defects. After that, the process we use to give it the final finish is a sandblast and anodizing. So the sandblasting, it gives it that kind of slightly grainy finish to it. And you have different grades of sandblast. So the higher the number, the more smooth the surface is. And the lower the number, the more grainy it is. So we use it around 80 to 100 grain. And that's sandblasted. Then after the sandblast process, it's anodized. And the anodizing is it's an electrochemical process. And what that does is it basically oxidizes the surface. And what that does is it gives it the kind of final color that it has. And it also hardens the surface so that it's less prone to scratches and damage.
Okay. So that anodizing process, how does that work? Is that an electrical process or?
Yeah, it's electrochemical. So you're basically passing a current through the aluminium, and it's in a bath of acid, and it basically you have a cathode and an anode, and so the aluminium gets plated basically by that process.
Okay, so that process is very similar to what you guys use on the regular Streacom products, right?
It is. It's actually the same finish that we use, yes.
Okay. So, for example, now that the project is close to completion, with the production being underway and soon completed, how would you reflect back on this whole Open Benchtable project to this point?
It's been great, I think. I can't speak from your perspective, but certainly for me, it's been a fun project, and I think what's been great about it is the fact that you know, because we do other OEM projects, and you know, we do products for other people, but what was great about this is I think we had a real kind of openness about the project in general. So it was. A lot of people, they come to us with very specific, okay, you know, they virtually have the finished product, they just need us to make it. Whereas this was a more creative process. So it was really fun to explore it. And again, because, you know, it's not a market that we're in, you know, bench tables, we haven't done that before. So it was fun to learn the new things that we needed to know to produce a product like this.
Okay, well, we are looking forward to see how it does in the market and see what people say, because that's the most important, right? It would be to hear out what the enthusiasts say about it.
Of course, it's always gratifying to know that people appreciate the product and actually want to use it rather than just say, yeah, that's nice.
That's nice. I put it on my shelf and, you know.
Yes.
Especially the point of that table is for being used, right? So you unmount it, you remount it, change the systems on it. We use it here daily at the office already to test systems. So for sure, for us, it's been great, but it's even greater for people that buy it. It's great. Well, thank you, Shimon. I think unless you have something else you would like to add or say, that's about it for the question I had for you today.
Nothing I feel I can add to that. I think we covered everything we needed to.
All right. So thanks a lot for your time, and we'll probably catch up and look if we can do maybe a little production behind the scene video maybe one day at some point. Who knows?
Yeah, you're welcome to come visit me here.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Tim.